BBC Audio presents Dear Mr Spectator, dramatised by Elizabeth Cootey from the 18th century Spectator essays of Addison and Steele. Series 1.
Monday, the 12th of January.
Hi there, can I help you, sir?
One large cappuccino.
I have passed my latter years in this city, and I'm frequently seen in the most public of places. And yet no one knows my face. I may seem attentive only to my newspaper, but I overhear the conversation of every table in the room.
Small skinny latte and cappuccino to go.
I have acted in all the parts of my life as a looker-on, and I have distinguished myself by a most profound silence. A silence which I believe gives me all the advantages of a dumb man. I move like a shadow through all the circles of society. With, methinks, a more than ordinary penetration in seeing, I flatter myself that I can make shrewd guesses at the inmost thoughts and reflections of all whom I behold, whatever their manners or station. Thus, I live in the world rather as a spectator of mankind than as one of the species. And since I have neither time nor inclination to communicate the fullness of my heart in speech, I am resolved to do it in writing, and to print myself out, if possible, before I die. I therefore proudly present this my humble daily newspaper, and myself, its author, to be known only and always as Mr. Spectator. Those who have a mind to correspond with me may direct their letters to The Spectator at Mr. Buckley's print shop in Little Britain Street.
Dear Mr. Spectator, having long been one of your most avid readers and finding myself facing the worst crisis of my life thus far, to whom should I turn but you for...
Mr. Mowbray, sir?
What is it, Jonathan? I'm rather busy.
Sorry to disturb you, sir, but I've had another look at that job for Mr. Barker and I think I've found the problem.
Which was that again?
The 8-day long case clock, sir, in walnut with the short bob pendulum.
Oh, the wretched thing is broken, Jonathan. There's no point fiddling on with it, and I shall tell Mr. Barker so myself when he comes tomorrow.
I think it was the lifting piece, sir. Just wanted cranking up a bit, and I've made some adjustments to the pendulum. Can I show you, sir?
Yes, very well. Go on.
What do you think, sir? Well done, Jonathan. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, run along now. I'm sure there's plenty more to be getting on with.
Right you are, sir.
Off you go. All right. Dear Mr. Spectator, having long been one of your most, etc., etc., worst crisis of my life thus far, to whom should I turn but you for advice? I am but a lowly clockmaker and...
Gilbert! Have you finished the alarum watch for Mr. Godshoe?
Very nearly, dearest.
He comes to collect it today at 11, Gilbert.
Righto, dearest. I am but a lowly clockmaker, fast approaching the age of 40.
He's one of our best customers, Gilbert. We can't afford to lose him. Are you listening to me?
What are you doing? Why are you not mending Mr. Godshoe's watch?
Kitty, I'm overwhelmed. I am... lost! I can't...
I thought you were nearly finished and now it seems you've not even started.
Cannot work today.
What? What are you talking about? There are clocks to be mended, Gilbert.
Mending clocks? The horrible irony. We may mend the clock, Kitty, but we cannot mend time. We cannot get back the time we have lost. It is broken forever, shattered on the floor, and its shards will not be mended.
What nonsense, Gilbert. What have you got behind your back? Give that to me, Gilbert. Give it to me. I knew it! The Spectator! You're at that wretched newspaper again! Mr. Spectator cannot mend Mr. Godshoe's watch! Is this all because of Friday?
Please don't mention Friday.
We have to talk of it, Gilbert. This is silly. We have the cake all planned, and the children and Jonathan and I have got up a little performance.
No performances, I beg of you.
And Aggie has fashioned it most cunningly. We couldn't have all the candles, of course. Well, you'd need an enormous cake for that. But she has made a decoration of a great four and a great naught, all of cherry-coloured marzipan, and we thought...
No, Kitty, no, no. I don't wish for a four and a naught of marzipan, nor of any other sweetmeat. 'Tis not a topic for sweetmeats. I'm joking! I have to get out. 'Tis philosophy. Philosophy must be my comfort now.
Nothing has gone well for us since you gave up business in the workshop and set up as a coffee-house philosopher.
Pretty Kitty, Kate, my love. One need spend but 10 minutes on the benches, and one meets customers by the dozen.
If you only did spend 10 minutes, but you're idling for hours over your coffee and papers, drinking and speculating.
The coffee house and the papers, they are portals, Kitty, to great streams of matter and rivers of information.
Hanging on Mr. Spectator's every word.
Catherine, you know my feelings. Next to Shakespeare, the Bible. And next to the Bible, the Spectator. Adieu, my love. Adieu.
But what about Mr. Godshoe's watch?
Get Jonathan to mend it.
Is he able?
Why do I have an apprentice if not to do my business occasionally? Farewell.
Men differ rather in the time of day in which they make a figure, rather than any real greatness above one another. Those who arrive at the coffee house at 6 in the morning, I call the blanks of society. They are altogether unfurnished with ideas until the business and conversation of the day has supplied them with some. They simply do not know what to talk of until about 12 o'clock in the morning.
Wife, fine.
Fellows such as these, I would earnestly entreat not to stir out of their chambers till they have sat down with Mr. Spectator and fully perused this paper. I promise it shall have a good effect on their conversation for the ensuing 12 hours. These blank men of 6 o'clock give way to those of 9.
Whether there is the merest chance, the island.
Ah, the war. For there must always be a war. These 9 o'clock fellows have plenty to say upon it. But by 12 they have drained their cups and gone about their business. We find, in their stead, the men of 12 flooding in from the law courts to enjoy some liquid lunchtime leisure. And as sure as the generations sink below ground and their places are taken by the next, so too do these men of 12 o'clock pass on, and in their stead we find the fashionable world who have made 2 o'clock the noon of the day.
Did I not spy you at Lady Bombast's masquerade?
Indeed, no.
The gentlemen who arrive at 5 of the clock are as motley and various as the weather. Students, playwrights, lovers, disaffected tradesmen.
I'm sorry, is this seat taken? May I sit here? Thank you. I am sorry to discommode you. Please don't let me interrupt your writing. Forgive me, the name's Mowbray, Gilbert Mowbray, of Mowbray's Clockmakers, Wentworth Street.
There are some men, and I confess myself one of them, who are not turned for mirthful meetings of men, nor for assemblies of the fair sex. And for this sort, the conversation at a coffee house may be more to his taste.
Sorry, pay me no heed. Scribble away. I'll just sit here quietly and drink my coffee. I won't say a word.
For here, if a man cannot talk, he can be still more agreeable to his company as a hearer.
I've got some writing of my own to be getting on with. In fact, a letter to Mr. Spectator.
For it is a secret known to very few that when you first fall into a man's conversation, the first thing you should consider is whether he has a greater inclination to hear you or that you should hear him. The latter is more often the case.
I'm about to turn 40, you see, on Friday. And I can't help feeling, well, you know, in my line of work, all you hear all day is the clock ticking. Or failing to tick. I don't know which is worse. It makes you wonder. Is this it? Is this all my epitaph? Gilbert Mowbray, son, husband, father, and he mended some clocks.
Can I fill your dishes again, gentlemen? Would you both like another?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.